Welcome to Ideas in Action, a television series about ideas and their consequences. I'm Jim Glassman. This week, how's your 401k? Would you trade it for a retirement plan run by the U.S. government? Given the recent performance of the stock market, it sure is tempting. And some people think it's a trade worth making. But what would a government-run system look like? And could it really guarantee you a more secure retirement? Joining me to explore this topic are Teresa Ghilarducci. She is an economics professor at the New School for Social Research and the author of When I'm 64, The Plot Against Pensions and the Plan to Save Them. Alex Brill. He's a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute and former chief economist to the House Ways and Means Committee. And Dallas Salisbury. He's the president of the Employee Benefit Research Institute, a private nonprofit group that studies the state of America's retirement system. The topic this week, should we ditch 401ks and let Uncle Sam manage your retirement? This is Ideas in Action.
Funding for Ideas in Action is provided by Investor's Business Daily. Every stock market cycle is led by America's never-ending stream of innovative new companies and inventions. Investor's Business Daily helps investors find these new leaders as they emerge. More information is available at investors.com.
60 million Americans now participate in 401k retirement plans. Plans in which they personally direct where their money is invested. In fact, more than half of all U.S. retirement assets are held in self-directed retirement accounts. And two-thirds of all U.S. households have at least some portion of their assets invested in them. But a recent report from the Employee Benefit Research Institute says that almost half of all Americans, from Gen Xers to baby boomers, will not be able to afford retirement and end-of-life care. One idea to avoid a retirement crisis, a government takeover of the 401k system. Key provisions of this proposal, tax breaks for private 401k accounts would be cut back, especially for high earners. The government would set up universal retirement accounts as a supplement to Social Security. Workers would be required by law to put 5% of their annual salary toward retirement, either in private or public accounts. Dallas Salisbury, we all know how terrible the stock market was in 2008, 2009. How are 401ks doing?
They're doing quite well. Is over 85% of participants have more money in their accounts today than they did before the stock market crash. And in the world of investing, they've been able to dollar cost average in at very low prices, which particularly for the young will give them great benefit.
And dollar cost averaging means you put the same amount in every month or every quarter.
Every paycheck, money's flowing into the investments that you have. Those people that aren't doing quite as well in their 401k accounts, well, people like me, old people that have been at their job for 32 years and got hit, and it will take me longer to recover. But that, just based on turnover in the American labor force, means about 10% of the labor force that has these accounts still has less in them than they did prior to the crash.
Teresa, to hear Dallas tell it, things are not so bad. Why do you want to completely revamp the system?
Oh, no, I hear Dallas telling me that things are actually pretty bad. Young people being able to buy cheap stocks now are good for them now. But you heard him say that for older people, depending upon those accounts for retirement, things are pretty bleak. I don't want the government to take over 401k plans. The government is now aiding and abetting them and subsidizing them to a great extent. I want the 401k system to have a serious competitor. And that competitor is a not-for-profit government agency, a quasi-government agency, that can help people save in a safe way and in a guaranteed way.
But it would be compulsory for people to make contributions under your plan
to
this government system.
If they don't have an equivalent plan, it could be a 401k, it could be a defined benefit plan, but it would have to meet better standards
but
than
they have. But just to be clear, if I had a small 401k plan and I had put a small amount of money into it, you would still require, under your plan, you'd still require me
yes,
to put money into the government
plan. I would, because people need to save more to get a decent retirement.
What do you think of that?
It sounds to me, Jim, a little bit like what we heard in the healthcare debate with the idea of a public option. I think we're all in favor of promoting retirement savings. And I think we all want to have more savings in the aggregate and on the individual level. I support the notion of having competition in this space, but I think we have competition in this space. There's lots of choices for an individual to make in terms of where they put their money, for employers to make in terms of who they use as their 401k provider. And I think that there may be bad apples out there, there may be funds that are charging high fees, but more often than not, we see a lot of success. Dallas described it effectively. People who are putting money in on a regular basis and who are educated about it are able to save sufficiently.
And yet, Dallas, people don't maximize their contributions. The average person nearing retirement has only $60,000 in a 401k plan. That's
pretty
scary.
Well, that actually isn't the right number. Is across all participants, you have those balances. For individuals that have had 30 years in a 401k plan, like myself, the average balance at the end of last year was about $200,000.
So, well, this still, $200,000 is not going to last very long either.
But this is $200,000 where, according to government data for the over age 65 population right now, the average financial assets is $17,000. $200,000 relative to today's retirees is a lot of money.
So you're saying that without 401k plans, people would really be in trouble.
And that's why I think Alex's point and Teresa's point really is the core difference here. It's really an issue, as with the health debate. The core debate is not between 401k and government. The core debate Teresa's raising is between voluntary savings on top of Social Security and a mandatory system on top of Social Security. That is not a criticism of 401k plans per se. What she's suggesting is we should require every American to save on top of Social Security. We do not currently do that. That, to me, is a different debate than is a voluntary mechanism. Do employment-based 401k plans do a good job of helping people voluntarily accumulate money? To that, the answer is an unequivocal yes.
I want to probe that a little bit, but I also want to make it, I want to understand exactly what you're saying. Could you kind of fill in the details of your plan?
We have a mandatory system now. It's called Social Security. We've had decades of experimentation with that, and we wanted to have a voluntary system on top of that. For decades, only half of the people at any point in time participate in the voluntary system. It's time now to recognize, for whatever reason, Americans don't save enough for their old selves. So I want an add-on account to Social Security.
Add-on account where people are required to make a certain contribution, but to a private account? Does the government have to be in control of this?
I think my plan has actually been distorted in the media, so I'm really glad that I can clear it up. I do want a public option. I want a public option. The people could have their 401k if it meets sufficient standards. The savings has to be enough. And I think Dallas is right. For some people like him, the system works. The tax code for people who have high income works, but increasingly it's a smaller privileged group of people that the 401k system works for. So I want, for most everybody else, a choice where they could save with low fees and a guaranteed return.
I have to disagree with Teresa on one point she made, though. Is she underlined that it is increasingly helping fewer people, and that is absolutely not the case. The 401k system as a voluntary employment-based program is helping millions of very low-income Americans, far more than ever have taken advantage of individual retirement accounts and other things. We have to be practical vis-a-vis economics. Is there enough money for individuals to be required to put additional 3%, 4%, or 5% of pay away? Can they really afford to do it? I think that's the fundamental economic question.
But of course, if they can't afford to do it, they're going to have a very, very rough retirement. I also want to ask Alex. Teresa's arguing that 401ks don't work for most people. And if that's the case, what free market plans have you seen that remedy the problem? And I think there are two problems. One is that people don't put enough in. And second, that people make mistakes.
I think that's right. When people start to contribute, could be better. People should be starting sooner. People should be putting more away. People should be thinking more carefully about how to balance those accounts so that they can ride the waves of the market. One way to do that is to change the defaults. So instead of mandating people into doing X, Y, or Z, we can say, financial economists can say, absent your choice, to participate, we're going to enroll you. If you don't want to participate in your 401k, just tell us and we'll take you out.
Right, so opt-in versus opt-out. Currently, you have an opt-in system and what you want is an opt-out system.
That's
you have
correct.
To affirmatively say, I don't want to be part of this.
That's correct.
So would that make a big difference? Wouldn't a lot of people say, gee, I want to opt out. I need the money to pay for groceries.
What we see is because the general structure is an opt-in structure, but increasingly employers are turning that around and making it opt out. And we see very strong results. We see people getting into the plan sooner, and we see the default contribution levels being higher. Yes, some people do choose to opt out. That should be their choice.
What about actually? I want to stop
very,
you right there because I think there's
very few. Numbers that opt out is actually quite small, and the retirement readiness rating we just released indicates that because of the reforms of the Pension Protection Act, the default enrollment, the default investments, et cetera, that for the lowest two income segments of the population, we're looking at the prospects of 7 times the levels of account balances as a result of those defaults, and they're not opting out, even at the lowest income.
Well, I want to get actually this philosophical question that Alex just raised. Some people want to opt out, okay? Is it really the government's role to say, hey, you can't opt out? We're going to require you to do this.
Look, 30 years of just encouraging people with a really expensive tax incentives to do the right thing is just not going far enough. And just like you can't opt out of Social Security, then we need in this economy, you know, decades after Social Security, just add another layer. So it's really not that different philosophically from what we already have. And I think some people do like the self-direction, and they should have their 401ks on top of that.
Not that different philosophically from what we already have with Social Security,
right.
What you're saying.
Right.
Now, I want to get to the details of your idea. You're saying that everyone would be guaranteed, I believe, 3 points greater than inflation.
Exactly.
Okay. So your returns, so if inflation is 3%, your returns are going to be 6%.
Right.
Who's going to manage this to make sure you get the 6% return?
You know, my inspiration comes from the pension plan that I'm in. I'm a professor. I'm in something called TIAA, T-I-A-A, CREF. It's a system that was...
I'm in that, too.
Yeah, I know. It was started by Carnegie. These teachers have big thoughts to think, and they shouldn't have to worry about their retirement. I have a portion... I've done very well in my defined contribution plan because my employer basically makes me do it. Makes me put a set amount in there, and I have an option to have a guaranteed return. This system was one of the largest pension systems in the world. Invest my money in a diversified account, and from that guarantees me 4% nominal.
Who
and it's not sexy.
I know, but who makes the choices about the stocks? I mean, a lot of people are worried the government's going to make these. For example,
I'd be worried
too. Let's say you've got, I don't know, an index fund. It includes BP.
Yeah, I agree.
And then something happens, like what happened in the Gulf, and there's tremendous pressure, political pressure, to sell the BP stock that's in the government-run account.
My plan has a very professional, insulated from politics, board of trustees that invests it according to the principles that they use to invest the Federal Reserve Bank's pension plan, which is a government program but run by the private sector. So there's a role here for Wall Street and for professional investors. It's just not that part of Wall Street that sells overpriced, inappropriate 401k vehicles.
What if they do badly? What if there's a stretch of time when this, for example, we've just had a period of 10 years in which the stock market has not gone up. It's basically been flat. So how are you going to produce 3% real returns in a situation like that? Does the government step in and say, well, you know, we're guaranteeing it, and so taxpayers are going to come up with the money?
Yes, it is a plan that will have surpluses during good times and to fill in these bad times. And there's no way that professional investors would put all this money into the stock market. It'd be a diversified fund. Government tips, you know, these inflation index bonds, which I have a lot of, so I haven't lost any money in this last 10 years.
Let me ask you one last question, and then I'm going to get to
Two.
Would the government have access to this money? You say there are surpluses in good years. Can the government take the money, as it does with Social Security, and use it for current expenditures of government?
Absolutely not. It would be a dedicated trust only to pay the retirements of everybody in that plan.
Okay,
absolutely.
So what's wrong with that?
My fear of this debate is, rather than judging the defined contribution system and K plans as against the objectives the law sets for them, how are they doing? And the answer is terrific. They instead will be judged against a different standard. And instead of the replacement being Teresa's proposal, the replacement will be a proposal that is far less effective in building savings, like a super IRA
system. I absolutely agree.
And that's a big risk.
No, I'm really glad we're having this conversation. I now understand Dallas's crankiness towards my proposal. I finally get it. It's absolutely right. I do not like the Obama plan for a opt-in to IRAs. They're much worse than K plans. So he has proposed, when he was a candidate for president, and now it's been made more explicit, that employers can opt out of this system. Bad idea. I agree with Dallas. Employers have to be part of it, have to help contribute. And people can just get tax credits from taxpayers to go into the individual retirement accounts. And they are terrible places to save for retirement. And that's also my objection to 401ks. It's a place where everybody can accumulate some money, but when they get a divorce, they get sick, their kids need to go to college. It's especially important for women. When the adult children come home and want a little cash, they take it out of mama's 401k or IRAs. So it's not protected enough from life's needs for money. And that's why I like my plan.
She says it's not protected against life's needs, but in a way, shouldn't people be able to decide? They're saving the money. If there's a crisis that comes up, shouldn't they be able to go into their retirement account and use the money?
There are, in the current system, there are ways to tap that money. There are emergencies. There are opportunities. You do pay a penalty when you do that. Some people do tap into those funds on occasion. I think that the data shows that it's relatively rare. But going back to the proposal itself, my concern is different than I think the ones expressed previously. It's not about a fight between what's the right plan. My concern here is in the guarantee piece of it, because the guarantee is very appealing. There should be some basic rate that we can expect, but there's a cost to that, and you alluded to that earlier. It seems unlikely that you wouldn't be able to provide this, but you never know. And so the notion, and this goes in part to the budget process that we have up on Capitol Hill, but I'm concerned that this might become a popular idea because it seems like the guarantee is free. And in fact, it's the government making a promise, and that promise has a cost.
By the way, there are guaranteed investment vehicles that people can choose in 401k plans. In fact, TIAA CREF has such vehicles, and generally they're kind of debt. There's debt, but it's a little bit more, a little bit higher return. They would probably return 6%, but they're private. So is that a substitute that would be acceptable to you?
In any case,
those aren't guaranteed either. I mean, obviously, whoever is saying they're guaranteeing it could go out of business.
Exactly.
Like Lehman Brothers could offer you a guarantee. I'm just doing the math here. You get a lot of economies of scale when a government the size of the United States can guarantee it over a long period of time.
And I agree.
And the Swedish government has. I got a lot of this inspiration from my own plan and also from the conservative reforms in Sweden. I really feel that people need to top off their Social Security and my guaranteed retirement account with a 401k with more savings. So I'm not one to take over anybody's 401k. I do want an option for most people
and
to put
Jim,
in
what
more
I,
guaranteed.
What I come back to, my father did have a pension on top of Social Security, plus he had the equivalent of a K account. My father was lucky enough to live until 94. But my mother, who just died at 94, lived 3 years beyond him. And for that last 3 years of life, her only source of income was Social Security, even though they'd done well through decades. The bottom line, we're in a town right now with a fiscal commission that is saying, can we afford Social Security? If we're going to do things with mandates, then I would suggest, in my late parents' interest, that we use limited dollars beyond what we're now spending, if we have to secure the Social Security program, before we look at taking money that essentially needs to be spent there to secure it and doing something different.
What happens? I want to ask Alex about this. I mean, we're in a period right now when I think it's quite glaring that lots of low wage earners and lots of people unemployed don't have the money. I mean, they just don't have the money to put toward retirement. They're trying to put groceries on the table.
It is true that we've seen a period of time in the last few years where wages have been rather stagnant. In large part, that's not because the cost of being an employee is fixed. It's because the healthcare costs are rising, and so the compensation is being shifted over to rising healthcare costs. But there's another thing that we've observed recently, and it's in large part due to the recession, is that the savings rate has actually increased significantly. And so the savings rate, which is very low in the United States, has gone up. And so if we could capture that behavior, that change, and make it permanent, and capture people and educate them now, allow them to make a choice, and say, continue to save. You're saving now because you're concerned about the economy, you're concerned about your job. You need to keep saving because you need to be concerned about your retirement.
Well, so why wouldn't people continue to save?
No, I mean,
they're already doing the right thing. They didn't have to have government tell them to do this in a mandatory way.
I looked into this, and I was encouraged for about 5 minutes. The savings rate is going up like it does in all recessions because people are not putting so much money on their credit cards. The saving is not in the retirement bucket.
Saving because they're scared?
Yeah, they're not spending as much because they're scared.
That's
it's
right.
really
it's
not, different. It's not retirement
they're not,
savings.
Absolutely, it is not retirement savings.
My point is let's
capture that behavioral change and try to steer it towards an automatic enrollment plan would be an opportunity to capture people.
Behavioral ideas on the margins might work, but I decided after when I wrote that last chapter, and not enough. Let's put some money on the table. $193 billion in a couple of years is being spent indirectly to help people have their 401ks. Is that money being spent well? It's $193 billion.
What do you mean it's being spent indirectly?
It's the tax breaks that people get to put money in their 401ks and their IRAs and their KEO accounts and their traditional plans, but that's falling. So that's money. It's indirect money, but it's money that's not being
if they're getting a tax deduction when they put it in, they're going to have to pay taxes when they take it out.
Right, so it's a little bit less than that, but you get the benefit of these tax-free accruals during your lifetime.
A quick note, the number is far, far smaller than what Teresa says it is or what the government says it is, because they don't do things like say, if you'd had all that money in the stock market with capital gains outside of this plan, you would have paid capital gains taxes.
I want to get to one last piece of Teresa's plan, which is the fact that when people save this mandatory plan, they don't actually get to keep or pass on after they die to their heirs what they've accumulated because you want them to have a forced annuity. In other words, people just like Social Security, you get paid only while you're alive and then it stops.
Yeah, no, and when legislators looked at my plan, we did agree that a small portion, 10% of your accumulation, could be set aside as a discretionary for bequest motives.
Do you see real changes coming on the horizon in our retirement system? And if so, what are they going to be?
I don't see in the near term that there's going to be a lot of change. While we're at the precipice of the expiration of the Bush tax cuts, and in those policies, we increase the ability to save in 401k, those tax cuts are generally expiring. The reality is that the policies that relate to savings and investment were made permanent already. And so there isn't that same motivation to go back and revisit the rules of 401ks and the rules of IRAs.
I think this debate is actually going to look at those generous tax subsidies for 401ks and probably redistribute some of those to lower income people. I think that's going to happen. Polling suggests that in the 2012 presidential election, retirement insecurity is going to be an issue, especially among higher income white voters. They're the ones that are most worried about their retirement. And tens of millions of people are becoming older every year. So I think the political, you know, ferment is there for some changes, and it would take some leadership. But I think, and I think about now, with the baby boomers getting really worried about their old selves, that there is a chance for change.
And you think, I know you've been up on the Hill talking about this, there's a lot of interest in your plan.
There's a lot of interest in doing something about retirement insecurity. There is now more interest in an add-on account.
Dallas.
I think you're going to see relatively limited action because of the challenges of the deficits and the growing challenges, particularly on national health spending. And that the best we can hope for is that they will secure Social Security mm-hmm. and that they will not mess up the very effective incentives that we already have in the system that are moving. Now we have nearly $5 trillion in assets in 401k plans and individual retirement accounts. That is magnitude of economic security. We shouldn't mess it up.
Thank you, Dallas. Thank you, Teresa. And thank you, Alex. And before we go, I want to remind viewers that you can catch Ideas in Action whenever and wherever you choose. To watch complete shows, just go to our website, ideasinactiontv.com, or download a podcast from the iTunes Store. And that's it for this week's Ideas in Action. I'm Jim Glassman. Thanks for watching.
For more information, visit us at ideasinactiontv.com. Funding for Ideas in Action is provided by Investor's Business Daily. Every stock market cycle is led by America's never-ending stream of innovative new companies and inventions. Investor's Business Daily helps investors find these new leaders as they emerge. More information is available at investors.com. This program is a production of Grace Creek Media and the George W. Bush Institute, which are solely responsible for its content.